And Damir had taken a stand to offer something today, so no one knows what that is yet. And I also want to have a space to some kind of a debrief or gathering of information from the last session with Clinton. So last week we had this space with Clinton, and I can feel there's some like my impulse is to let some of this gold come here, like something needed to percolate with that. So I was just, Damiet, how long do you want?
It's an open space, so I don't like I what I'm taking on is what Clinton has proposed about the cafetation space. So this is what I want to jump into doing that. So and knowing that this is a new space, I don't know how long it will take. I've never done this before. So let's see how much time is needed for Clinton and then see how much space we have left and use that.
Okay. Cool. So then I will aim to finish by 9:30, and then pass that space over to you then.
Yes,
So
thank you.
one of the things that has been percolating in me since last week is the power of questions in spaces, and how the questions determine where the space goes, and what you know, the question also determines which answers you get in a way, and how useful they are. So we had in the village, the New Zealand Village Telegram group, we had Liz asking in the last week about, she asked the question, are my sharings too long or not? Please give me feedback. And she asked this in a few groups, and most of the answers she got were yes or no. Yes, it's too long. No, it's good. And so her question was towards people's box preference about is the answer too long or not? You know, my box says it is, you know, it's too much to read. And my box says, oh God, thanks, you know, thank God somebody is writing a lot. So, you know, so I don't have to, for example. And the box answers are not so useful. You know, they just tell you what other people's boxes like or don't like. And in terms of like how to like what transformation or clarity she would want to bring in her sharings, it doesn't give any information for that. Like, you know, so what would she actually want? And so some people, you know, brought this next question. Like what is your real question? What, you know, what do you actually want to change, for example? And so what I noticed with Clinton last week was that if you know, he asked this powerful question in the space. What would be the most powerful way you could use this space today? And it brings this real tension into a space, like, you know, what is it? And then brings also our questions on the surface. And let's see. I think the first question I have is like, how was it for you to be in a space like that, like this level, like what Clinton brought? How was that for you? What reactions did you have? What questions came up? What did it move in you? Or what clarity came from the intensity of also his asshole energy? You know, Clinton also brings this conscious asshole energy there to bring the space liquid very quickly.
Yeah, for me, it's still left that I there's anger happening in my house, so that's why I just muted. Yeah, like it's left it left me right from the beginning. I noticed that I had my gremlin in the space, being determined not to get hooked by his conscious asshole, and therefore I was already hooked because I was. In a protective, like, you're not going to get me kind of space, and therefore not connected. And with all his questions towards me, I couldn't see the gold. I couldn't receive his feedback. And that is still the space for me now. And I would love to hear what you saw. What I did not saw is a bit what Susanna just bringing you in, you know, there's spaces of my gremlin that I don't see, and there was something happening that I wasn't able to receive the feedback. And yeah, I felt sad about it afterwards, and it's still not clear to me what he was trying to bring to me. Yeah, I had a lot of unconscious fear underneath of him coming in, and I really allowed it to be covered up. I wasn't bringing that into the space. What I could have said would be like, I'm really scared when you're bringing me your conscious asshole, and I have this thing with him that he then goes straight into my confusion box, because that's what's happening to me. Then I go into confusion. I cannot understand what he's saying, and I'm pretending that I am. So I'm pretending that I understand while I don't understand at all what's going on. Yeah.
So, Sibylla, what would you say was the question alive in you in the space? And I'm saying, like, also an unconscious question. For example, how do I not get hooked right now? Would be, for example, a question that you did not have clear, but it was like working. Or how do I pretend not to be hooked? Something like that.
Yeah. How am I pretending not to be hooked right now in the space? How am I doing that? How is that visible to you? But that would have mean I would have known, needed to know that I'm hooked, and I wasn't aware of that.
Yeah. Right. So you are hooked, and then at the same time having this question, how do I not be hooked when you're already hooked?
I was in, like, on some level there was a mixture, because I was still like, okay, I'm ready, you know, like, come and get me. I'm gonna be there, and I'm gonna stand there. So I had quite a lot of I had some conscious anger alive to not get hooked, and underneath that I was hooked, but this was at the front, so I couldn't sense the other part, but he did. So yeah,
thank you. Somebody else?
Yes, I noticed I didn't have a question, and I felt fear, and I allowed myself to feel what was there, and I really appreciated his the anger that he brought and the clarity that he brought into the space. It was like I have discovered another level because of that, of myself. And I'm just, this is just kind of dropping in a little bit more now. I've got some things happening in myself personally that I've been unhookable with those before. So it's like he's cracked something else open. His presence has cracked something else open for me. And it's like a, what I'm feeling at the moment is this deeper level of sadness, this crack in the wall of my heart, which is starting to open, and I can't hide from it anymore. It's like I have to deal with that. And I still don't really have a question. I just really wanted to be there and I guess I have, you know, I have questions as, you know, is what I did, you know, did I waste the time that was there with him? You know, what would be the right answer? You know, what does it look like? What is the most powerful way you could use the space? You know, what is that? What does that look like? And for me, I feel what happened for me was really powerful. I also want to say that. So yeah, I really appreciated that I made the time to come, and I appreciated the experience and what's happening inside me now.
And would you say there was something between you and having a question or knowing what your question was?
Well, yeah, I think there is, because you had mentioned, you know, bring your questions, and I'm going, I'm just so not prepared for that. And I didn't have anything. And it's like, I feel like I should have had a question.
Yeah.
Yeah. Rather than just let this, I really love spaces to unfold. I really don't like forcing things. And I'm noticing this happening in the unhookability for sale that I've created. The space unfolds and this magical connection gets created. And those are the spaces, and we go deep, really, and it gets deeper all the time. And those are the spaces that I want to create. Yeah.
And are like, because what I'm like exploring is, because what I notice is when there are questions with really like a necessity, this makes like it's like an engine in the space. So I guess that's also happening in your unhookability for sale, that people bring these questions and it brings like a necessity for information to come and discover the next space, the next possibility, the next distinction, and so on.
Yeah, I'm not sure about there being questions. At the moment, we're working on resentments and expectations, and we went in one, and because we start talking about this, it shows up, and we use the chat during the week to share what's happening for us, to ask for support. And so that enriches that for sale. And then when we come together, there's already this energy in the space that wants to move through us. And so that's what happens.
So it's not a question energy, it's like it's an energy for removing resentments, for example.
Well, it's a discovery space. It's a discovery space where we can share and request feedback from others. And we often do ask each other questions. So yes, there are questions involved. Yes. So,
Thank you. I mean, discovery, I think, is also based on questions. Thank you,
John. I have a point here. I haven't been in this call, and I realized for myself that I somehow, through going through the school system, I'm not used to asking questions. And maybe there is some practice, or maybe you have some ideas. How is there a possibility to somehow internally develop more questioning mind? And I do not need an answer right now, so this is also a question.
Susanna, what comes up for me with that is curiosity.
Yes, and there is something missing to the question. From the curiosity is something like the ground, and how the question is getting something into a form.
So did you like, so you asked this question now, Susanna, about what is the, like, is there something blocking questions from the school system? And then Joe, you brought the answer. Well, you brought an answer, and I don't know if you noticed, but this, like, then the question died. It was curiosity. You know, the question is answered, and then the energy, this tension of the question, dies. So there's even something there about to have fear or or whatever, like to have something, some training, like training to avoid even the tension of unanswered questions, I would say. And that, yeah, I'm so curious about that. And also that this can come from school. I totally think there's something there.
I think this was also what was going on for me. I didn't really want to answer his question because I wanted to be in the space with the question. There was a, like, if I answer the question, then what happens to the question? The question that Clinton, I wanted it to percolate. It's like, oh, wow, yeah, what would be the most important thing? I didn't have an answer. I was investigating internally. So, yeah, I'm curious about that.
Yeah, and I think you're bullshitting yourself a bit there, because that's because you were hooked. So when you're hooked, it's not really possible to let something percolate like that, because you're already defending yourself against it.
I definitely, when he first asked the question, it was just like this big wide, like, wow, okay, what could this space be? So, you know, it was just a closed, being hooked all the time, there was definitely this like, wow. But yeah, not going deeper in it, or not having an answer.
I would like to share what happened for me, because when the question of Clinton with the pressure came, there was so much pressure in there, like, what is the most important question to ask? And I felt this
one thing. This is vacuum.
Oh, this is the vacuum.
Yeah. So this was an intense vacuum, just for you, because I know you're doing this healing process work. But this is how intense a vacuum.
Right. Okay. It felt this pressure to me, but I understand what you're saying, like, because I felt the pressure myself, but it was vacuum of like, what is it?
Yeah.
And the pressure inside of me was like, I had this really big question in me that I didn't want to bring, because I think like, well, this is not something that you can bring to PM, because this is Clinton who's coming. And I felt like the hierarchical kind of still working in me of like, this is the big man. And but I felt like this is a big question that I have about PM, because I just arrive into this space and I see how PM is also like dividing cultures, like how it in this community, and where's the diversity? So I was really sitting with, well, what about these people who don't want to do PM and who are in the who are part of our population and who have really great ideas themselves, like, and they just split off. And I felt like this happening in me when this question came, and then can I bring this? Because this is my question. This is something that is steering in me. And do I then speak from this place of like, okay, what is really important for me? Because I can only speak about me at this moment, what my question is. I cannot think of other questions. So I felt this like, okay, do I need to say it? I'm really feeling the fear. Okay, the fear, that is good. Lean into it. Just do it. But there was also this emotional fear. So I just like, and when he said like, tick tock, tick tock, tick tock, I was like, oh, fuck, this is like, it's so important. The time is ticking away. What do you make from the space? Like, how do you create? Like, this is creating time. Okay, go. I felt this like, okay, I need to bring it all. Yeah. But then, oh my gosh, have I taken up too much space with my question? And is it clear enough? So then the questions about that are coming. So that's what happened inside of me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. Dami, one thing I noticed is that this, you brought this question about, you know, what you said about, I don't know what it was exactly, but how PM is also being used on the shadow side and Tui and, you know, something around that. And he didn't answer that.
Mm-mm.
You notice he just skipped that question and he went, you know, went somewhere else. And so then for me, it brings the question, you know, what was the real question? Or what is the assumptions in your question? For example, maybe there's this assumption that possibility management can be used or can contaminate a community which is a crazy assumption, because possibility management is a whole set of tools and distinctions and so on. And it's not that itself, it's who it's used by and for what purpose it's used. So there might be something to unfold there for you to like unfold. What is the question actually? What is your real question?
I felt the real question coming. The real question is, are you willing to take this step and lose the friends that you have? And that was the question that I really had. Like, do I really want to continue PM when this is happening in my life and I want to hold on to people I love? Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. Okay. It's 9:30 and I would love to hear from Ingrid. And then I have also like the kind of a, I have like a 6-minute exercise about this questions. So how about we, would it work for you, Damiet, when we shift to you at 9:40?
Let's see what will happen in this time with what I have. But yeah, let's go with what is needed right now.
Okay.
Yeah, for me, I noticed fear in my child ego state and fear in my box, or by consequence of my box, when Clinton asked us the question. And during the time he was there, I noticed also, and it's not all, only with him, that the clarity he brings, he hold, there is a part which becomes super calm in me, through energetically, when I feel that. And I noticed this during the time he was with us. I noticed, there is the part which becomes really calm. And so I saw these in me, those two different states. And what I loved after he left was really that even then his energy was still there, and I felt really joy about the about trying those his tools he suggested, just to try it and to be. I made an EHP after that, because I wrote you in the Telegram group. I tried to cavitate space, and I got feedback from you. And after that, I really, there was in me child ego state and parent ego state fighting, that I took too much time. I took your time, and I don't bring value to the space because of that. And I did EHP, and in two parts. And there is a child. Fear about before the shame came up, I noticed really to be totally glad in a space where I don't know what I'm doing. It was really, I felt so much joy, and even you gave me feedback, and also I didn't understand it, even that made me feel joy. And the shame part came only up when we left, and this was something between parent and ego state, child ego state. And I'm still working with that.
Thank you, Ingrid.
Thank you.
Okay. So I have this exploration, and this is to that we spend now, let's see, Let's do 4 minutes. And there's the 4 minutes is to feel into what are your questions and around space holding. Because you're all, you know, we're here in this space holding trainer space. And so to feel into that, into your questions, and to write them down, write a list. And don't really, this is like a draft list. So don't think about it too much. They don't have to be perfect questions. Just get them out, get them on the paper, bring as many as are there from whatever angles they are there. Go ahead. Okay, and finish the one you're on. And I'm going to send us in breakout rooms gosh, we're not going to make it. Damn it. Does it work for you to shift to the next session?
My proposal is that we drop my jumping in because it's getting shorter and shorter and that we just continue with it.
Okay. Okay, we put it on the shelf.
Okay.
So I'm going to put us in breakout rooms in pairs and to have to take 5 minutes each. So one person reads out their questions. And in that 5 minutes, your partner is to give you feedback and coaching about the effectiveness of your questions. For example, which assumptions are behind the unconscious assumptions are behind the questions? Where's the question coming from? Your box, your gremlin, your being. Which kind of answers is your question targeted to? How is your question narrowed to stay safe for your box? Or how dangerous is the question for your box? So, and you discover more ways, more feedback and coaching about the effectiveness of your partner's question and give that to them. And we'll harvest afterwards. What did we discover? So we've got 5 minutes each. And please, somebody take care of the time. Whoever is giving feedback and coaching, you take care of the time, the 5 minutes. And then switch over. Anything that needs to be clarified? Okay. I will jump around because I am extra. So I'll see you in there.
Hello, Susanna.
Hello, Jean.
I have started the time. I'll jump in and do my questions.
Okay,
so how do I learn distinctions?
Pardon,
how do I learn distinctions?
I just make one proposal that Susanna holds the time while you're doing the questions, Joe, so you can have full attention there.
Okay. So yeah.
And did I get it? So do I go in there at once, or do you read the list first and then?
I would read the whole list first.
Okay.
Yeah. Can you start again, Joe? Yeah.
So how do I learn distinctions? How do I deliver distinctions? What do I do when I go blank in a space and don't know what to do? What are the expectations of me as a space holder? How can I learn quickly? How can I get distinctions like vacuum and pressure into my five bodies so I get them? What do I do when I don't know what to do? How do I hold a space when I have something going on emotionally? How do I use my fear consciously to navigate spaces? How can I grow my mimetic speaking delivery and bring this into life as a whole, so even outside of spaces? What do I need to do to look after myself?
Excuse me, what? I didn't get this, the first word. How can I
grow my mimetic speaking delivery?
Mimetic speaking.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
And then how can I bring that into everyday spaces of my life?
Yes.
Not just in a held space. What do I need to do to look after myself as a space holder? Like when I don't like or want to hold space. How do I navigate the matrix I have, in particular when I'm in a situation outside of my matrix ability? And that's where I got to.
Mm-hmm. The last one.
I feel just joy about there are so many questions. Like you said, you had no questions with Clinton last week, and so but they are I can also feel those questions have been alive in you for a longer time.
Yeah, and I think they're stupid questions, so I don't ask them.
Wow.
This is the school. Oh, wow. Yeah.
What's the feeling?
Yeah, I feel sad because I don't want to look stupid.
Yes.
Yeah. And I think I should be, because I'm in this space, I think I should know these things already.
Mm.
And yeah, I just have a lot of fear now.
Because?
I feel like I really exposed myself, like my limitations, and I had fear the other day that I shouldn't be here in this space, that I'm not in the right place, and I think it's to do with what I said earlier about Clinton coming in, and I feel like I've gone back to where I was before I started, maybe even my diminishment, and I mean I haven't, because I still have parts of it, but it's like I get that I'm in a new layer.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel really wobbly, and like, you know, old resentments that were there before, they didn't bother me, but because this has opened up again, it's like they're there with a vengeance, you know.
You mean about the spaces, or about your personal life?
Personal life stuff has started to like open up again, right. And I can actually see it playing out, and it's like I don't want to let it go, and I feel fear about that.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
So there is really a fear to be exposed, like to be exposed where you are, where you actually are, by what questions you really have.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Oh.
And what I also...
Yeah.
What I also noticed, there's a lot, the questions circle around the... being with the fear and about the not knowing. So about learning fast.
Mm.
And what about what's happening if I don't learn fast, or if I don't know, or if I am in a space where I don't have the matrix, or it's all the questions circle around this issue. The fear of being emotional, having emotions in the space. This is all around this.
Mm-hmm.
Being not at the fullest capable, whatever this would be, at whatever assumptions you have around this.
Yeah, thank you.
And the time is over.
Thank you. I'm going to jump into another room too.
Yeah, thank you.
That I'm not getting it. I'm scared that that I'm missing something, or I'm not seeing what others are seeing. Or, but there's something about the relaxedness. So you know, it's like how does one anymore relax as a space holder? How does a space holder relax? How does a space holder just be in spaces? How do I just be in spaces without, like, still holding space, but without switched on, alive, bring, la, it's just this, yeah, so there's anger, I feel angry. So, because I don't know how to be in a space anymore. This is like the what I discovered in the other day. It's like, I don't know how to be human anymore.
Yeah.
In ongoing,
the question, Sibylla, about how do you be in normal life is like, it's like blocking you from finding that out. like you're asking for this safe cushion of something to save it for you or something like that, where actually if you remove that question, like this quest for this safe, normal, cushiony thing where you can relax, it's like, where's the cover? Where's the teddy bear that I can cuddle so that I can relax or something like that?
I'm looking in modern culture, like I'm on some level trying to compare to others, like how does normal life go for other space holders? Like where can someone show me how this goes? Because I don't know. So
that is the
first kind of layer of
of
looking outside of me, basically. I'm not looking inside of me how this goes. I'm looking for answers. Yeah. And I'm comparing.
So what would the question be if you were the source?
How does relaxation look for me? Like what relaxes? What is being space for me? What is relaxation for me?
This is asking for an answer. So like, what can I do? So you're more in this, like, what eye are you in when you say that? What can I do?
Yeah.
When I'm in the liquid state.
Yeah, it's again from my side, it's a parent ego state and I've that unconscious fear in me to let the participant on its own leaving. And what I usually offer is write me a word when you need me or something.
I think it's something else. It's not your parent ego when you're asking that. I think the parent ego is the one that is scared for it.
Yes.
Your box is scared for it.
Yeah.
So when you're asking the question, how do I know what to do? What do I do when I'm in the end of a session and someone is in liquid state and I don't know how to end? What do you do with that question? What kind of ego state do you bring in? For me, my reaction is I want to give you an answer. What you need to be doing. So my parent or my rescuer comes up to, when I hear you asking that question. So I think it's from your child.
Okay. Yeah, I get now. I was at the wrong place. Yes. Okay. You spoke about how the question is landing. Yes.
Yeah.
That child you said. Yes. Thank you.
Yeah. What can I do? This was the 5 minutes. Yeah, when you say what can I do in the end, you're putting your authority to someone else.
Yeah.
So a better question would be more about, like, it's more about the ending and being in liquid and being with fear around like that. I would think about a different way of formulating what is happening really with you on the end of a session and seeing what you need to be doing with that.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. Yes. What I notice in general is I have difficulties sometimes to mention my fear in a space when I'm noticing that it's coming up, and I have the tendency really to push it away. So what can I do so that the fear...
Drama comes. Here we go.
Susanna, will you continue?
Pardon?
Will you continue?
So what if when my anger is so high, so that I use my parent ego to crush the space, like not go with the space, but really crush the space by landing distinctions or like being the knower? What if my clarity, I cannot somehow separate my clarity from my parent ego.
Mm. Ingrid, would you finish your question too?
Yeah, my question was at the end, what can I do so that my fear, which I have the tendency to push into unconsciously, stays conscious?
Mm. Yeah.
Okay. I also got a bit of a sense of what, so yeah, the exercise was to start with the first question and then find the real question behind it. Is that?
That part wasn't clear. So some people also started with all the questions and then we found like the common thread of the feedback and coaching. So it was fast, and what, like, I jumped in all the rooms and I have been flabbergasted by the amount of information coming through. So it's layers there to explore, and I would just like to harvest what came up already. So what did you notice? What blockages, what distinctions did you find? What discoveries did you make just during that 10 minutes?
Yeah, I realized that my questions are valuable, and my fear of not asking them because I'm going to be wrong or told off is actually getting in the way of sharing my questions, my judgment, self-judgment.
Yeah, I would add more to that because I was there when that fear came up, and it was incredible to see that Joe had like 10 questions. All of them, like, so, like, you know, I felt, whoa, you know, like, I felt this joy come in my body about this questions and this aliveness and this curiosity. And then as soon as they were out and, you know, me and Susanna were there, like, whoa, like, feeling the impact of them, the sadness and the fear came. And it was like this fear about how visible you are. How visible are you when you expose your real questions? Because it shows where you really are. So thank you for that, Joe.
Yeah, for me, it was really the gold, what Damiet gave me as a feedback, that in the space, I have parent ego states going on, also the I know space. And my question about that comes out from a child ego state. So in the space, there is parent ego state going on and making something. And the question I had about that came from a place of child ego state. I want like a tool to have an answer. And that was very valuable. That is very valuable for me. Mm. Thank you. So what I see through that is the ping pong going on between child and parent. And this is really something I feel when I'm holding space, that when parent's ego state is going on for me, it becomes in myself a ping pong between those two parts, and I have difficulties to be anchored in the adult ego state.
Hmm. Well, thank you. Can you repeat the question one more time, Ingrid? Like the question that came from your child ego state?
Yes. This was the question, what can I do when a participant is at the end of a space super liquid?
Okay.
And I told Damiet that I feel that there is rescuer part in me, rescuer something going on in me. And I think Damiet felt that. I don't know. What did you feel? How, because it was so valuable for me what you said. What was the sense you got, Damiet?
When you asked the question of what can I do to end like with this, there was because there's unconscious fear for you when the liquid state is happening and so allowing you saying like, what can I do? It landed in me like this was a question that I wanted to answer with my like, oh, I've got the answer for it. And so my parent came up to, so I felt like this was a child's offer.
Yeah.
Mm. So, and also this is interesting, the, like where the question is born from. So when it's born from the emotional fear, then it's born from an unhealed space, like a survival space, actually. It's a survival question. How can I survive the end of my training spaces?
I feel some joy. Sorry. Yeah, were you finished then, Tristan?
Yeah.
Yeah. I feel some joy with the time with Sibylla. My first question that came to me was, what is blocking me from being fully in this possibilitator space? And then Sibylla navigated to like, what are all these assumptions and shoulds that you've got? And it's almost like I've just sort of opened this container and it's full of all these assumptions and shoulds, which are all like little gold coins that I can put in my own little evolution machine. And just like this whole extra thing of healing processes that I'm like, ah, okay, I've got all this stuff to work with. Yeah, I feel glad about that, to get there.
Thanks, Elliot.
Yeah. Thank you.
Welcome, Anna.
Welcome, Anna.
Hello, Anna.
Thank you. Hey, hello, everyone. Hello, good to see you. This is a very mixed group. From all over the world. Cool.
Anna, yeah. we've been deep in discovery for the last hour. Is there anything you need or want?
Yeah, I would like to have just like take some time to connect, to let the yellow stuff come and be there and see each other. And really going through breaking the illusion about a physical separation. Thank you for inviting me. So you have been already in a meeting. Something to say about it, something to share, celebrate, or ask.
I just wanted to finish the space. For me, it was mostly really recognizing how many EHPs are in those questions, like doing it with Elliot and also in myself. So like, oh wow, okay, there's another way of straight away finding all my next what's in the way and what work I need to do. And I will mute here and then because there's building going on around me, so I want to keep the space quiet, not with building noise.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sibylla.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sibylla.
I want to celebrate the aliveness that I felt by doing these exercises with the questions. I felt turned on by that, like and looking at that and creating this space of discovery. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm celebrating this clarity of all the shoulds and the assumptions that I have about how I should be in this space or how this people in this space should be. And I'm celebrating that's now a collection of things that I can work with to discover more about who I am in this space, my space holding identity.
Will you share one assumption?
I should be active all the time in the Telegram group.
This is already an expectation.
Yeah.
What is the difference?
The assumption is a story that I believe is true. And the expectation is just did this. The, yeah, an expectation. Yeah, I don't have the answer. And
someone, yeah, go.
And I have done this recently.
Mm-hmm. So you should have the answer. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. Yeah.
Elliot, is the assumption that everyone in this group should be really involved in the Telegram group?
It's more like my assumptions don't spread that far to It's more that I see people involved in the Telegram group, and when I see that the messages come up, and I actually don't have an impulse to message or anything, and there's like this, you should put yourself in that space. You should be replying to people's messages. You should be doing this. You should be doing that. And it's what my gremlin is doing with that, to create this pressure, which is actually creating a me from holding back as well in the space. It's like having, yeah, the shoulds and the expectations are like, there's this battle within me against them, and my gremlin's manipulating in some way that actually I hold myself back because there's an expectation.
And what is the feeling?
Fear. I feel fear. There's something about missing out, like missing. I'm afraid to miss out on something. I'm afraid to
What will happen if you miss out?
Miss out, I'll be alone, and I won't have anybody to connect with, or to there's something deeper below that though.
Mm-hmm. And so this is an emotional healing process doorway.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So the difference between assumption and expectation is that the assumption is this first step when you believe the story is true, right? But you are not applying this with the should. The should is like almost the applying on everyday life. So for example, a trainer is an extroverted person. Therefore, you should write down messages in the Telegram group. Yeah, so it's when I apply the assumption into life, and I literally, I'm waiting this to happen. Yeah, I'm expecting this to happen. And so from the big generalization, I go into a specific case that is happening right now in my life. Yeah, and this is where I take this picture about having this toolbox with one certain shape in it, yeah? And I expect the other person to be as my shape it is, because an expectation is nothing else than projecting my wants, so myself, into the other person. It's almost an elongating of myself on the other person. And then it should is, yeah, putting the other person into this shape. So if the person has a circular shape and I have a triangle, it doesn't fit, and I force this to happen. And in this, I'm getting more disappointed and more disappointed because it doesn't fit. So I want to squeeze the other person into the shape that I'm expecting her or him to be. Yeah. And I do this also with myself.
Yeah. Yeah.
An expectation is fantasy world. An expectation, it doesn't exist. And I have this shape and I try to squeeze myself, yeah, squish myself into this shape. And when I do not recognize that it is an expectation, then I will get just constantly disappointed. And if I get constantly disappointed, then I will have the resentment. And if I cultivate the resentment, then I will feel betrayed by someone, for example, or I will feel disappointed on myself. And then all the circle of, yeah, the gremlin feeding is totally alive.
Mm-hmm.
And when with other people or with life, yeah, with circumstances or other people, is where also this experience of, because you are not as I expect you, you betray me. You are not this man that I want. So you betrayed my and this gives me the license to take revenge of the partner. Yeah. So and I am totally in this hypnotized by the expectation. Mm-hmm. Good. Thank you, Elliot, for sharing.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah.
And I'm still celebrating, because now is another layer.
Cool.
I just want to share with you, Anna, feels for me in the space important that we explored questions. Where do questions come from? How is the effectiveness? What determines the effectiveness of the questions? And also, like, what happened in the last session with Clinton? Because, for example, with Joe, like, we made this experiment to write down all of our questions and then to give feedback and coaching and partners about where the questions are landing, where they are coming from, which kind of answers you will get. And Joe had like 10 so real, clear questions. And none of them came last week with Clinton. They were like, something was blocking them. And it's like, to see like, whoa, what is, and also this fear that came up also with Joe to make the questions visible. And it's to be so vulnerable, because when your real questions are visible, it's to be with your ex on the map at the same time. Yeah.
Thank you. And you all explore that? You all explore what happened last time with Clinton? How was his experience to you?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
I was not here. Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah. Okay. And now? Do you notice that the space you are holding space, Tristan? Do you notice this, how the space doesn't, you know, it is, yeah, totally in the air?
Yeah. Yeah, I noticed that. It's because it's actually the first time we had a TTTS, like another space, so it'll come after the first hour. So, yeah, it's, I can feel that.
Mm.
So,
what is the feeling?
Well, I feel fear, because I miss the possibility here. So it's unknown, and I feel and I feel angry because I want to pass the space holding to you. And I feel fear if we have to just really end the last space and start again. And it kind of feels like that's what is needed. So that would be my impulse.
This is a good thing about possibility management, also to have a start over tool. This is such a great opportunity to do it again. And what I noticed is that I came into a space that wasn't closed. It wasn't complete.
Mm.
And so how come this happened?
Well, I had this thing like that if we get the space rolling, then it would also be like a respect for you as a space holder to come into a rolling space and join the momentum. But I see it does not work because you were not part of the beginning, like the birth of the space. So that's why.
Okay. I don't think there is like one linear answer to this, you know, like it is possible to create spaces in spaces, and I see it wasn't clear to you which space are you holding. And this is, I think, the wobbly part. So let's have a start over. Hello, everyone.
Hello, Anna.
Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you for being here.
Yeah.
I have a question. How do I navigate the matrix I have in particular when I'm in a situation outside of my matrix ability?
Can you repeat your question, please, Joe?
Yeah. How do I navigate my matrix, the matrix that I have, and in particular when I'm in a situation where I find myself outside of my level of ability of matrix, like the situation's bigger than my matrix?
Well, the thing is, you do not navigate your matrix. Your matrix is like you sail to navigate spaces. Yeah. And depending of the density of your fabric, you can use your matrix as more wind can blow into your sail. Yeah. And I don't think you can, let me see. I think already recognizing the matrix, you know, recognizing, oh, there is something happening that challenges me. Yeah, for example, yeah. Challenges my abilities, I don't know now, like it is like a riddle situation. So if you have a specific situation, it will be more appropriate to put it on the table. And in the moment when you recognize, then it cannot be outside of your matrix.
Can you say that again?
In the moment when you recognize, oh, this is too big for my matrix or something, this is what I understood. You said like, oh, this is like too much. Yeah, then in the moment when you recognize, you are already, this is already part of your matrix, your capacity, your competence is to recognize it. So I don't believe it can be completely outside of your matrix if you are recognizing it. Otherwise, it will be invisible to you.
Mm. Okay, thank you.
So, and I think it's more maybe the thing about your level of competence is not well developed, or there is a fear of being a beginner or not being elegant with that.
Mm. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I was in a space recently and I was like, okay, where do I go now? I was holding space for an EHP for someone that I hadn't held space for before. And I just found myself in this like really low level of confidence.
What is that? What is confidence to you?
A feeling of inner strength and trust. I think I lacked trust that I had the ability to do what I was doing. Feeling like confidence is like feeling like I have things under control, you know, like I know where I'm going next. And you know, I realize by saying that I'm not stepping into the unknown.
So I would like feel scared of feeling confident in an emotional healing process, mm-hmm. because then the space is not alive. And I still don't know the feeling that you are feeling when you say you are confident.
Yeah, there's anger on board. There's fear beside. Yeah, there's joy beside. It's like, it's like all the four feelings are there and are available for navigation when I need them. And lack of confidence would be not having access to those. I think I'm just getting that now.
Yeah, well, I heard something different when you describe the confidence and you say I have no control. Yeah. And this is because when you I think this is totally a myth. This is totally like a story about holding space and having control. They are totally different things. They are like almost opposite territories to be. So what I mean is that there is nothing about control in holding space. Mm. It is about to be in your fear. And so how I sense it is more, it has more to do with being a beginner. So how are you when you are a beginner and are you not elegant, you know, and you maybe you take longer to find out what is the impulse, or you get a beep because the impulse did not work. How are you with that?
Yeah, I don't like beeps. And I don't like being slow.
Which eye is speaking when you say that?
Oh, this is my box. Because it likes to be on. Mm.
Mm.
So it means that when you feel not confident, your box is speaking.
Thank you.
And there's the shift into like really to leave your box and to let your box by side and being in connection with your client is, and be scared, as a be shitless scared about holding an emotional healing process because you don't know what will happen and you need the fear.
Yeah, and actually I'm realizing that came in when somebody said after doing an unmixing emotions, they were exhausted. And the fear was, oh my God, they can't do anymore. This needs to finish. Yeah. And then.
Okay.
Yeah.
I am curious about like the start of your question, Joe. Like I was feeling the do-over. And I was feeling into that space of like, okay, what will happen? Like, how do we do a do-over when Anna enters into the space? And then your question came. And I was wondering, like, what was the inspiration to bring that question on that moment?
Notice the space was quiet, and I saw an opportunity to ask one of these questions, one of the questions that came out, and I thought I would be bold and I'm feeling fear now that I might have done the wrong thing, and I just thought I would be bold and go there anyway and see what happened. Yeah.
Thank you.
And how do you feel right now, Jo? What is the feeling?
I feel fear and I feel some sadness.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What are they about?
Fear that I've done the wrong thing, and part of me knows I haven't. And sad because I keep questioning myself and sad that this gets in the way.
Mm.
Yeah. Sad because I feel I feel really vulnerable and bugger it, I want to ask it anyway. And if there's a beep, I'll get a beep. And that's the way it goes.
Go, Jo.
Yeah. Thank you. Damiat, tell us, who are you?
Where am I? I am a human being in here, and I am. Oh, am I? I am light. I'm a light being, and I'm in this human experience. And I have these human experiences which brings me either in light or dark or doubting myself or being present and fly.
Will you share with us one light experience? You said it brings you into the light and into the darkness. What is a light experience and what is a dark experience?
A light experience for me is that I feel like I'm connected. I feel like my center is connected to Gaia, and I speak and things flow through me. And I feel alive when we're speaking about these questions. And I feel I'm light. I feel light. I feel like when I'm more dark is when I think like I'm doing something wrong. So then the question is are coming in and like this, the gremlin comes in. And this is more like it feels like the dark and then I'm doubting and I go in instead of expand. And I'm more like, oh, done something wrong. And that feels to me more dark. And yeah. So that's part of my human experience. Then when I say that, it's.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Okay, so tell me, what do you want?
I want to fly, and I want the people who fly. Yeah, and what do I want? I wanna be in this space that is transformational and have connection and that's what I want.
Mm-hmm. And so tell me more about that. Tell me more about, because you said you want to spaces of connection, and this is also where the light experience comes, and I'm curious, how do you create the illusion of this connection?
That's exactly what came up, like how do I create when I'm just going to say like what came up for me in the silent moment in between the two spaces that's with the do-over, I feel like, okay, and now we're in this space of openness And now this is the time. What can I? What is needed? What am I waiting for someone else, or am I doing myself something to create? So that's why I asked the question to Joe about,
mm-hmm.
like, what inspired you to say that question? Because this was my question: How do I create that? How do I create what I want of intimacy and transformation? That's by going.
How do you create first. What you want? Okay. Will you share with me first the answer to my question and how you create this connection?
I create this connection by saying where I am and bring an offer into the space to create what I want, but I don't know what it is. So I'm just feeling that, like, this real, like, this fear inside of me, like, oh, there's this opening and I don't know how to get there. So yeah.
So I mean it is in yourself, right? Because this is like the first hypnosis that we have in our life, is to believe we are disconnected from everyone or from everything. And this is already an illusion. So how are you telling yourself that you are disconnected? What is your, you know, what is your programming to believe you are disconnecting?
So my programming goes like, my programming goes like, oh, if I'm going into my head about, like, when the stories are coming up and the judgments are coming up of what I've done wrong, I don't know. Like, I don't have the answer for the question. And then my fear, my emotional fear comes up, and then it takes over into my head. And then I feel like I'm not connected anymore. I'm not connected to you because I'm in my head. I'm not connected to the earth because I'm getting wrapped up in emotions. So that's.
And you say, I feel disconnected. What is the feeling when you say that?
I feel, well, there's sadness and there's fear. Mostly.
What is the mixing of these both?
The mixing of the sadness and the fear? It causes me to become quiet and to bring confusion and to shut me down.
Yeah, to isolate.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you believe that you are disconnected in the moment when you mix sadness and fear, because it causes isolation in your system.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, I have to figure it all out myself. I need to hide, don't show, because, like, I will be a loser. Something like that will come up. Yeah.
And I think it's a really great, you know, possibility of experimenting. You don't need to connect, because connection is already there. The starting point is we are all connected. And, you know, you are part of nature, so you are connected with nature and with all the other humans who are also nature, and with all the other beings that are in nature. So this is the starting point of being on Earth. So wanting to connect is actually, we say in German, double gemoppel, right? Because because it is already there. So you don't need to do the extra thing.
Is to say, I what I actually want is to want to connect, but not to connect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and if your starting point is you are already connected, and you really refuse, you refuse the hypnosis of disconnection, what is different in your life? Mine is a question for everyone.
I don't have to do anything for that.
And then?
Well, it is here already. So I don't have to have any stories about it when I'm disconnected or connected, because it's already here. So there's already one layer has been taken off of needing to do something to create a connection, because I am connected.
Yeah. And where is your center? Where is your attention when you have the experience of disconnection?
My center goes out, my center just goes out. Yeah. So my center goes to my head.
To your head. So what about the others? When you feel disconnect, when you have the experience of disconnection, where is your attention? What are you busy with?
With the others.
With the others?
And what they will think of me.
Okay.
Or feel about me. Yeah, there's my attention.
Mm-hmm. What about the others?
Trigger sentences.
For me, it varies. So I can give my center to somebody else. I can get triggered. I can discover a resentment. I can, there's lots of different things.
Mm-hmm.
For me, it's big victim sadness, like this kind of trigger sentences first, and then this kind of dead kind of, total victim sadness, giving up space
mm-hmm.
through the disconnect. Mm-hmm. And when you say that, Anna, we are always disconnected, we are always connected in that space. That is like, I am really curious how I can make myself a bridge in that space, because that just seems completely unbelievable or not available. There's a real curiosity.
When you are in the cave already, you mean?
Yeah, yes, when I'm in the cave, but also I have a story that there's a lot of people who can have a sense of that connection all the time, and I am curious how to build the bridge to be able to feel that all the time, you know, to what you're describing of that we're all like starting, the starting point is we're in connection.
Would it not be that you would stop trying to build a bridge, because this is your default state, is to be connected? Like if you're looking for it, if I'm always looking to be connected to something, then I'm trying to build something on top of, I'm covering up my already default connection state.
And this is what I mean with the attention, yeah? Because if you are having the experience of disconnection, your attention will be placed on the disconnection evidence.
Mm-hmm.
So it means mm-hmm. you will be busy with the things that separate you.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And the most is the evidence. You will have the evidence there, and the evidence is like the, you know, the repeating pterosaur thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Where you're chewing over and over and over again.
I just mm-hmm. find that's the shoulds. Like for me, that's the shoulds.
Yeah.
The disconnect comes from the shoulds.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
For example,
I mean, this is the thing that it is, you will find like different things that you can get hypnotized with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They let you think, let you believe, you know, and there is like the assumption about the story. You can be disconnected. You believe the story that you can be disconnected.
Mm-hmm.
So it's more about taking away this story than building a bridge.
It's like taking your, you know, taking your towel, and rather than to put it into your mouth or in your room, to start to take the dust off. Yeah. Of the hypnosis.
I mean, I had a crazy, such a clear experience of that. A couple of weeks ago, removing a resentment about that other people are not flowing energy back to me for what I give to them, and when I'm holding spaces, and it was just killing my whole impulse to hold spaces. This resentment, or this expectation, this assumption beneath it, I was sick of it. and for a few days, totally disconnected. And then I took the resentment away, and straight away there was this energy to hold spaces again there. And I also wanted to share that I found in a healing process there to come into even the bubble of modern culture, I chose to disconnect. So it happened in my birth into the culture there. So it's not just a personal story, it's a cultural story that you can be disconnected, I would say.
Well, a cultural story is made by personal stories.
People.
Yeah. But if you are holding space for a group of people, yeah, you have totally different start points. If you're, your experience is being in connection with whatever is, or being disconnected from whatever is. Joe, you had something to say.
Yeah, I have a curiosity of, you know, like we talk about resentments and expectations and assumptions as being, you know, the shadow side. Can we make those into a bright principle side? And can we make an assumption and an expectation that attention and connection is always present? Can, you know, like what's the danger of having that as a possibility? I feel like I'm not clear.
I would most say, Joe, that it's a story, like whatever your story is about, we're always in connection to make a new story that you want to change your mind on, possibly. What is your story? What story do you want to make about being in connection?
Yeah, and an interesting thing for me is I've all my life, I have always believed that connection just exists. And it's only since I've been in Auckland that I've been hearing this disconnecting thing. So I have this in my last 4 years. I don't have this in the prior part of my life. And I'm hearing that, yeah, I'm just playing with an idea, not for me, but for lots of people around. Can we use this assumption, expectation thing to create something new?
I think it is really necessary to make a distinction between connection and intimacy. And that there is not the same, and I choose places to create intimacy. And then these relationships, they transform, they evolve, they change, right? Where I create intimacy. And still I can have a very, you know, intimate moment with someone for 2 seconds of, you know, just someone who gives me the money back, and I can have this two seconds of intensity and intimacy. Yeah. And so it's not a question of, in my experience, of time. Yeah. Because the thing is, this connection or the other way around, said stories happened in time. So if you are in this mall now, there is no story, right? In the three seconds is a storyless time, a storyless experience. Story happens in time. So the more you want to extend, yeah, your now, the more are you falling in the story about something or someone. And this is the thing about being a possibilitator, is that you choose which story, because you know there is no story that is true. So you choose a story.
Anna, what do you make the distinction between connection and intimacy?
Connection is, I would say, like related to the bright principle of connection. Mm-hmm. It is happening. Have you seen the roots of trees, you know, these pictures of the roots of trees, and they are all connected, and you can see this incredible like pictures under the earth. Yeah. So, and also when the tree seems to be separated from another tree, the connection is just always present in their systems, yeah? and the intimacy happens by choice. I choose this to happen. I have a purpose. I have an offer. I have an input. I have a, you know, this is like, it is my, the choice of developing, of offering, of proposing something. It is the way of creating high drama, going into a conscious action of creating intimacy.
Thank you. Yeah. I can feel the connection lifts behind it, and then from that I can create intimacy.
And the more you know, and this, you know, you have heard about this creating a new game world that makes the old one irrelevant. And this is very, very, very similar, because the more you're fighting your trigger sentences, the more you're putting attention on your isolation, the hypnosis is getting your attention, the more you are feeding this with your attention, because that is where your energy goes. So you use the, you know, the fertilizer of your attention to create what you don't want. And to take your attention back and to really put things in place, like, for example, you know, your voice blaster, yeah? And take your attention back to what are you creating? What is the game world you are really turned on by? What is so inspiring to you that your heart cannot not do that?
Say it again, please.
What is your heart so turned on by that you cannot not do that? Yeah, it's just flowing through your veins. It's in each cell of you, the being turned on by something. And putting your attention on there, on what are you creating with that? I have seen a lot of fighting mode against the hypnosis, you know, of the programming of the survival, yeah? And going in drama because of my survival. So I am in drama because of my drama. And this just sucks your energy constantly. And that's why we start with the first position, right? If you are not owning your attention, it will be taken. Your gremlin loves to feed on your attention. Yeah, this is energetic food. Your gremlin will take it, will place it somewhere, and will create low drama. There's nothing bad about it. It's just what gremlin do. And you will not stop fighting on that. So what are those spaces that turns you on? Turns you on so much?
I want to share an experiment I do since 3.5 weeks. And I chose for that two more difficult relationships. And what I do is, when I think, when I speak on the phone, and when I see the person, I put 100% of my attention on myself, not on the other one. And I'm focusing on, if attention is coming up physically, if a thought is coming out, oh, he does it again, or he's again shouting at me, or an emotion, fear, or whatever. And innerly, I say out loud this one particular thing. For example, physically, oh, I feel restriction in my solar plexus or something like that, or the thought or the feeling. And then that the most important step for me, I go out of my head, go strictly on my heart level, and there I open, because usually those things close my heart. And then I open instead, and I feel the pull of the story which is linked to that. I just feel it on a heart level, and I relax into that, and I let go, and I go back to 100% of attention to myself. And this is making me happy. It's you ask what is turning me on. This turns me on. I can't say how much. And I do it now with much more persons. And I do it with things. It's my constant exercise. And yeah. I'm crying, I'm touched, but I feel joy. I feel joy.
Thank you, Ingrid. Will you share with us what for different results are you creating with this experiment?
First of all, I'm much more centered myself.
Mm-hmm.
And when I open, when I go out of my head, when I open my heart, and when I feel the pull that's gremlin, the pull is gremlin, it's low drama, and I relax into that, I let it go. I forgot your question.
What for different results are you creating with this experiment that you did not have before?
Yeah. And what I notice is, I'm saying sometimes less. I notice also that my ears are still functioning, and my mouth is still functioning, and my eyes are still functioning. So I can nevertheless speak or react or say something. What the difference is for me, the result, what is different is less hooks. I will give a concrete example. One of the persons is my husband, and my brother came, and he said to me, "The knee is so relaxed." And I know it's because of this exercise. So the different result is he is relaxed. He feels that I'm working, and that I'm able to, that tensions goes away, and that's the result.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not only with him, but that my brother noticed it. I was so blown away when he said it to me.
And what does it mean specifically? Because when your husband is, when he is relaxing, is this what he's doing? But what I see it is your contribution is the space that you are creating. So the space that you are, you know, creating makes it like the possibility for him to relax, and he chooses to relax. So which kind of space are you creating when you do this experiment?
More freedom. for myself also, and for the other person also. I create a bigger space.
A bigger space.
I create something I think a little bit, I forgot who said that, you said that I'm putting away something which I imagined was in between us, and this is not longer anymore there.
So from your description, sounds to me very much like expectations. Yeah, it could be part of what happened before, because expectation, and this is what you write, what you see in spaces happening when you remove expectations, when you withdraw them, is that the spaces make a big sigh, it relaxes. Yeah, because the pressure of squashing this space into the shape of your mold is not it's not there anymore.
Yeah, thank you for putting word on it. I like that. Yeah,
I also really hear the space being free of gremlin in the way you're describing it, Ingrid. That there's less gremlin in the space, so there's more space to be and for you and your partner to relax into what the space is.
Yeah, I'm avoiding low drama. This I'm conscious about, yes.
Thank you for sharing, it touches me.
And my gremlin, I ask my gremlin to help me with that. He is telling me to do that. It's his task. And he loves it.
So thank you for saying that, because it is an unconscious gremlin-free zone. Yeah. So don't let your gremlin be the bad guy of the story. You know, and it's easy to blame the gremlin. So guess who is doing it? To blame the gremlin. Yeah. So, but like to really start to already using the skills and the nonlinearity, the forces of your gremlin to create spaces. Yeah, free of expectation, free spaces, for example, yeah? It is much more powerful than no gremlin in the space. So you use your own resources, all of them.
That really lands for me.
So I just love extraordinary spaces, and whatever, to be in the spaces where this tingling of team comes together to discover something and create something. So the Akiaki River space, where we are creating this money game world, this next culture money game world, this space. I recently watched this film called Freedom Writers, where this teacher came in this class, and after 1 year, this class with all these, it was like four gangs in the class, the Asians, the black people, one white person, the Hispanic people. And she created a space where it was possible for them to go from killing each other to connection and team. And this touched me so, so deeply. Yeah, I love these spaces.
What makes a space extraordinary for you?
The when when the space is safe enough for the real questions, the impulses, the information from the beings in the space to come alive and create something together, like this dance of creation together. and to sense what is the creation? What is the next creation? What is the creation right now? And to be so, so present with that right now, what is emerging?
What is that right now? What is the impulse you have?
Right now? I this was my impulse to share that, my impulse right now. This was my impulse. Now I really wish to hear from other people also what is bringing them alive, but I wanted to put mine.
So are you telling me you have no impulse?
No, I'm not. I'm telling you my impulse is that my impulse was that. Now my impulse is to wait and hear, listen to what the other people.
The impulse is to wait.
No, not wait. It's to. I want to hear what turns on. I want to hear the answer to your question from others.
Mm-hmm. From whom?
From everyone. So
who is first?
Susanna.
I knew.
You knew this already.
So there are different traits which are turning me on. And right now, this question comes right now when my body really tells me I want to go to sleep. So what's turning me on? So actually, healing spaces are turning me on. And there's extraordinariness in these healing spaces because they are so unpredictable. I enter this space and I do not know what's going to happen at all for the whole time. I even don't know when I'm in this space and it seems to flow, how it's going on and how it's going to finish. So, and this is feeding me somehow. This is feeding me. This being in a fear space for such a long time. And this is, I feel it's totally selfish because I'm so turned on by holding space for healing processes.
Mm.
And and it's changing right now. My life is changing because I'm becoming more visible and I'm going more out. And I have on the same amount, I have fear and I'm also turned on by this new experience which is coming, so that people are reaching out to me. And I also have to declare things. So I have to position, I need to position me in and tell about me.
Tell us about you.
But I find out that a lot of things which come out, which surface now in my life have been dormant long times and have been like showing themselves a little bit and I could not recognize them. For example, being a healer, that mm-hmm. this has been dormant in my life, like showing a little bit of it. And now it comes out like mighty with a like a torrent.
And how is that, the torrent in your life?
It's what you said. Yeah, I cannot not do it. I really try to stop it and say, okay, I become very sensible, and I do not do any emotional healing process this week. I do not take any client. I do not talk to anybody. I do not go into spaces with my daughter or a friend or anything. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. So there are people coming and I simply cannot not do it. I can't close the door and say, no, I'm not available today. It doesn't work. And I even tried very hard to get normal, sensible jobs, like in modern culture, to earn money and be very sensible. And it doesn't work out. I do not get these jobs where I could earn a lot of money and not.
I have a question, Susanne.
Yes.
When you told us that you cannot not do it, the EHPs, you bite your lip several times.
I'm holding something. Yes. Okay, I'm aware. This is a gremlin habit of me, like checking myself, not playing full out.
Can you repeat what you said about you are not able to not accept EHP without doing it, playing full out?
So what's exactly happening is I could do more EHPs. I could hold more spaces. It's not enough.
Thank you. That's valuable information, Susanne.
What is the fear that you are not taking a stand for it so boldly?
So the fear is the voice in me is saying, I'm hybrid. It's hybris. Yeah, it's too much. I'm claiming something which is too big.
And then, too big for whom?
So people who do this are crushed. Like, this is my story at this point.
People who do this are crushed. Like, you are crushed or the clients are crushed?
I would be crushed, yeah, if I not control this. So this is my control thing.
So if you just this place in you, this turn on your heart, you give this a sound, just a part of you this turn on without the controller. What is the sound?
I understand there's a part in me who can make this sound.
Yes.
Okay, and this turned on being with the sound.
What is the sound?
I make it not so loud, yeah? It's like...
Because it's night?
Because it's night and...
Yeah. <it's>
like... Yeah. And I'm doing it again, holding
Let's
back.
Let's go. And have contact with us. Stay in eye contact. Go.
The eyes are closed. Again. Without glasses.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Look how you are turning on everyone. Everyone is already like 20 centimeters closer to the screen.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Go, Susanna.
Thank you.
And then this feeling, like this emotion of I could be too much, is gone. If this is. And I feel very much when I get, especially Sibylle gives me such a vibe, like, yes, I get the full yes. Thank you.
Cool.
Thank you.
Go.
Thank you, Susanna.
Thank you, Susanna.
Thank you.
The things that turn me on. So what turns me on? Something that turns me on so much that I cannot not do it. What I notice in my, yeah, it's, something happens with me where I am creating, like, I get a lot of joy out of this, just like, so I work at this, my job here at the gardens, it's like it's happening there, where there are lots of different things that are coming into the space, and I'm sort of creating, there's so many things that are alive in this space now, are like there to serve lots of people in community and things like that, and like I've said yes to them all, like brought them all in, and there's a part of me that's just, there's a shadow part with that, but there's also a part of me that's just so like alive and feel a lot of joy about this, just this like, ah yes, let's do this and let's bring this and let's go, okay, is that going to work? No, I'm not sure, well let's try it anyway, and experimenting and it's almost like tinkering and creating things for in collaboratively creating and creating spaces for other people to come into to benefit from and to serve.
And so you said you're doing this in the gardens.
Yeah, like I think it's part of the reason that I'm attracted to like community as well, like TUI. And so I do it in the gardens, but also it's like this, how do I even describe it?
Don't go in your head to describe. Go
right. Yeah, yeah. Thank you. I just wanted, yeah, I'm kind of like, so I stick with the one example, which is at the gardens. Like we have this space here, which is for the community, and or it's just, it's not, it's a space. And I've been there for like 1 year, and now we have like, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe 5 different initiatives that have arrived in the place that I've said yes to and brought in. And it's not, it's also not just I, it's like in that collaborative space of like, hey, what about this? Like, let's try this. And I'm biting my lip and I don't know how to quite explain it. Like that's what. That's
who are you there?
Who am I there? I am. And I'm full of joy there, and I'm very. Who am I there?
You know, I saw the other day this article in the newspapers about you. Yeah. And they say like this the SLC garden manager.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I thought, oh man, this is this title. Yeah, it's way too small and boring for Elliot.
I have this so much like this. I can't say it anymore.
So like, who are you? This is like the polite title, but who are you really in the gardens?
I'm a guardian of that space. I'm a guardian of this junction where people can come together and bring energy and can cross-pollinate and find something inspirational there. This space is like a junction for people to cross paths and touch and exchange and experience something very, very inspirational. And I am the guy with the, I don't know, you know, like the traffic guy with the sign.
The traffic guy with the sign.
Yeah, and the junction going. Yeah, and I.
The conductor.
The what?
Conductor.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. And.
can you let this land?
Yeah. Ah. Yeah.
Conductor?
Yeah.
Yeah. So from garden manager to the traffic conductor is not a real improvement.
No, but Anna, this is because but that's because you can't see the junction that I see. You know, it's not just like the only way I can describe it is a road, but like because this is what I see in my mind.
Yeah, this is totally bullshit. We cannot see it. Make it visible.
Yeah.
We will see it.
Yeah.
Bring this to us. We will see all of this. We will smell it.
Yeah, okay. So this.
Go through the sounds. They need to happen in order for you to find the words.
Yeah, okay. This space, this sacred space that I steward.
About it. Open your eyes.
Go. Keep connecting with us. Keep connecting.
This space that I'm stewarding is like this golden bubble of it's like this it's almost like a reset space where you can come away from what is out there or whatever whatever's been going on and come here into this space and you can sit on the grass and you can sit on the grass and you can look around and you can feel the energy of this place and it can reset you. And when you've been resetted, you can stand up and you can go into the space further and further. And there's so much, this corridor of this space, you can go deeper and deeper into it. And the possibilities of what can be created there in collaboration are endless, and it's a golden corridor of creative possibilities, and I am uh, I am the corridor.
You are the corridor.
The golden corridor.
Unexpected possibilities.
The reset corridor.
Good to meet you. I know which way I will take.
Yeah.
Okay. I want to share. Thank you, Elliot.
Thank you.
The spaces that for me, it's like what I'm really beginning to sense, it is really not so much about what I'm offering in the space or what is on offer. It's about the space itself. So for me, what totally turns me on is, like the other day, everyone here around here was doing something in connection, and the space was just fully alive. There was connection and action happening in all the different spaces. And what I am in that space is just the joy of connection. Like I go there and I connect with people, and then I go there and I connect with that project, and I go there and I just find myself alive just in the space within the connection of all the different people. And yeah, like an a space that fully is for me alive is and where I come alive is also doing the same thing with youth. So the other, like last week, we had a whole bunch of young people being part of the creation of this house, and what totally turns me on is the spontaneous offering that they're bringing and that I can then go with and create connection from. And yeah, just the real joy of being together in the space. And for me, it comes through the clarity of the space. Everyone is in, everyone is there, everyone has a yes to whatever moves in them, including myself. And then, yeah, then I come alive in that space with that level of clarity and kind of commitment from everyone, including myself. Yeah. Sorry for the banging. And another really big part for me, what totally turns me on, is movement. It's just as soon as I am in movement and being in movement with others, I have access to my being and to bringing my being to others and recognizing others' being. It's a place beyond beyond the concepts of words, beyond the concepts of expectations, explaining. There's just this wide open space that comes in alive with movement, with being in my body and being with others in their bodies.
Thank you. Tim, you just had a big exploration, 1 hour, I think, about questions. Is any question coming to you?
Yes. The question is how much are you looking for these spaces outside, and how much are you creating them? How much are you looking for? How can you be the source of them?
The movement spaces I'm not creating at the moment. And I have a lot of sadness around that and questions of why not. And yeah, there's a clarity of how many other spaces I need to let go of in order to create that space. And how I am creating the spaces around here. And I have this longing for almost this, yeah, like I want to be able to walk into those spaces and then be in the space with my aliveness. So there is a there's a part of me that is just, yeah, like a child part of me that doesn't create them and has all sorts of it's more that those spaces also feel like childlike. They feel like an alive space of, there's something, there's a wider story there for me that those spaces just come. They have their own, you know, like joy only comes on its own accord. It has its own, there is a part of me that doesn't believe that I can actually actively make them happen. So I can fly in them when they're there. There's a part of me that just doesn't, where I'm not seeing myself, like I can see myself that I'm the source of them, and I'm also doubting and just not feeding that part of me to create them. And it has a lot to do with the shoulds. Like, these are not very reasonable spaces. Like, they're, yeah. And they have its own magic. They just come when they want to, when the universe allows for magic to happen. And I have some sense how I can create them if I can stay unhookable and create magic. I had that this morning. And often it's, there's this like, whoa, I don't know how to make this happen right now here.
So Billa, what are the expectations that are getting in the way of creating what you want?
A lot of the shoulds are about the wheels that I've put into motion. I need to be responsible and move them to the end before I can create something new. So there's this responsibility old map of, there's no time to play. It's like, these are play spaces.
How come you are choosing the old map of responsibility?
How come? There's just this connection of, yeah, an old story of what life should be. This is how it should go. This being responsible, making an income. There's a big piece in, I need to be responsible for my kids. I need to create an income. I need to, so that's how, yeah, that's where the old map of responsibility is active. And then that goes with that, about being in a response.
Yeah. So my question is, how come you are choosing this?
How come that I'm choosing this? I'm choosing this because I don't have my attention on my, yeah, I have my attention on the shoulds and the responsible parts. I don't have my attention enough on those spaces and those risks. It feels risky. It feels more, I don't have my attention enough on my being in that way to follow my being's impulses.
Be, Sibylla, when you choose the new map of responsibility? Who would you be?
I'm more connected to my joy and to my aliveness being.
How would that look like?
It would look like that I don't feel so burdened, and my parent ego would be less active. I
can't see it.
Say what?
I can't see it.
You can't see it.
The thing is, you just describe what you would not, but what would you? No.
I would be at least dancing 3 times a week. I would also be sharing that so much more with others, the joy of movement and the joy of lubricating next village. I would be relaxed in spaces and just letting spaces be. I wouldn't slave myself forward in this. Yeah, I'm going backward. I would be owning my attention in each moment that I'm in and meeting each moment, and therefore being fully where I am with my physical body fully.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you everyone for inviting me. I wish you a very expansive travel in the corridors of possibilities. Have fun. See you next time.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, Anna. Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye.